Welcome to Empowerment Word Church, where we empower people with the Word of God to live, fulfill, and be. Live a life that's pleasing to God. Fulfill the plan of God for your life and be witnesses and ambassadors in the earth for Christ. We are led by Pastors Sean and Gwen Edwards. Visit us on the web at empowermentwordchurch.com.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. It's so good to see you. Welcome, 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 man. I'm super excited. Oh my God, what a time of praise and worship. He reigns, everybody. I'm telling you, man, listen, praise and worship was awesome. I sense the presence of the Lord in this place. Amen, amen. Listen, I'd like to welcome each and every one of you to Empowerment Word Church online. Amen. Welcome to all our Empowerment Word Church family, all our first-time viewers. Thank you for joining us, and all our regular viewers now since we've been out here for a while. Thank you for joining us. Hey guys, it's a special day today. I bet you're wondering. Listen, it is a special day for us fellas. Amen. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers. Come on, fathers, make some noise. Amen. Come on, make some noise. Listen, if you with your father's still living, man, listen, give him a call today. Give him a high five. If you there with your dad, your husband, listen, hug him right now in Jesus' name. Happy Father's Day. Come on, y'all can show him some love. Come on, let's bless our fathers this morning. Amen. Listen, man, I'm so thankful and grateful just to be a father. I just remember having my first child, my first son, and it just changed my life. And I knew that I had such a great role model. You know, I had a really, really great father. I mean, a real man as a father who taught me so many things. And my dad is in heaven now, but I tell you, I'm so thankful and grateful for the times that the times that we shared and things that he imparted. Man, fathers, you guys are special. Fathers are special in God's eyes. They have a great impact on their children, on their families. They carry the weight. They carry the weight. If you just really understood the weight that a father carries, you know what I mean? And so today, happy Father's Day. I want to encourage all those who have, listen, treat the dads real good. Treat the fathers real good is what I'm trying to say. Amen. Listen, love on them today. Cook them their best meal. I know for some folks going out, maybe not. Listen, whatever you do today, just make it special. Amen. And for all those who father is in heaven like mine, just reminisce, man. Think about those wonderful times that you had with your father. Amen. Just those great times. And for those who might not have had a biological father in their life, what about that extended father or that stepfather or that person that came into your life and really filled that gap for you? They're special, amen. So again, happy Father's Day to all our fathers. Listen, it's our day. I know it might not be as hype as all the Mother's Days. I know, but listen, I'm a father, I'm proud of it. And I want you, those who are watching, all you fathers, listen, man, you're special. We need you, especially in times like these. We need our fathers, man. Amen. So happy Father's Day again to you. Amen. And so I pray you have a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful day. Amen. Just a last reminder. Again, we're opening July the 12th. I'm getting excited about it. I pray you are. And make sure that, you know, we're going to make all those necessary adjustments that we need to make. And for those who still a little leery, listen, we're going to try our best to keep things online, things going. We're working out some kinks now as we speak. And so prayerfully that we'll be able to simultaneously have online as well as going live as well together. And so we'll see how that works. But July 12th is the day, amen, amen. Well, listen, before I jump in this lesson, because we started a new series and we called it Time to Pray. Somebody say Time to Pray. Oh, it's time to pray, amen. And so I wanted to pick up a part two and really unpackage this Time to Pray message, amen. But before I go, get started in the word, I want to go ahead and pray. Let me pray. Father God, now in the name of Jesus, God, I thank you for the privilege and the opportunity to be able to stand here and share your word. Oh God, I believe I'm anointed to teach and to preach your word, and I believe the people listening and watching all over the world are anointed to receive your word. I declare that this word shall fall on good ground and produce a harvest in the lives of the people today. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Listen, come on, let's get here, man. I'm telling you, Time to pray, y'all. Well, today I want to give you part two of this particular message. And today I'm titling this piece here, Persistence. It's the secret of prayer. Persistence. It's the secret of prayer. But just a really quick review from last week. We talked about what is prayer. A lot of y'all are familiar with what prayer is. It's communicating with the Lord. It's communicating with God. Matter of fact, to define it even more clearer, it's your legal right. It's claiming, it's opening a personal conversations with the Lord, amen. It's communing with God. It's communing with him in order to understand his heart and his purposes. And so to really have a gist of understanding this prayer, it's time to pray, especially in times like these. It's time to pray, amen. I'm talking about it's time to pray. And we talked about last week, why was prayer important? It's important. It's important for you. It's important for me. It's important because God is limited by our prayer life. We said that last week, and if you missed last week's lesson, listen, just go back down and look at the lesson from last Sunday, amen. And those who just want to go to the website and listen, go to the website and listen to last week. God is limited by our prayer life, we learn. We are commanded to pray. That's another reason that why we should pray. And it's our necessary link to receiving God's blessing. Then we found out that we are co-laborers with him. In other words, partners with him in the redemptive process. And then finally, when we talked about why is prayer so important? Because God intervenes in the affairs of men by invitation only. Oh, that's good news. And we found that out last week. But this week, I want to pick up another piece this week. I'm calling this persistence. Oh, you got to be persistent. It's the secret of prayer, amen. And our foundational text, we really came from, I'm going to take you to Luke chapter 18, verses 1 through 8. I'm going to refer to all eight of those verses here, some parts of the message here. But our foundational text, just that one verse, this whole lesson was derived from verse 1, when it said, "Then he spoke a parable to them, that men always ought to pray and not lose heart." How many know that? We ought to always pray. You ought to always pray and not lose heart, because the reality is we have to continue to pray, especially in times like this. We can't lose heart. I understand that all the challenges and everything that's going on around us. So in especially times like this, it's time to persist in prayer. Amen. We got to stay persistent. We got to persevere. But before I jump in the rest of these verses, I wanted to make some comments about in order for prayers to be effective, because we want our prayers to be effective as we are being persistent, amen. We want our prayers to be effective, and so there are some conditions I believe that need to be met, and I want to give them to you as I look at them here. And when I think about it, the first one I believe that we need to make sure that is met, this particular, what I want to call it, it's a condition that must be met for the prayer to be effective. Amen. And here's the first one. I said that our prayers will not be answered unless we have a sincere, true belief. Unless we truly believe, have a sincere, true belief, because Jesus said something like this. He said, "Therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them." Believe that you receive and you will have them. Listen, that is something that we have to have a sincere belief in our hearts. I know here, even in this text, that Jesus is talking with his disciples and he's reminding us about some things. And so that's a good reminder. But we need to have you need to believe in what you're praying. You need to believe what you're praying, amen? Because to the Father, there's a text in Mark 9, it says, to the father of a demon-possessed man, Jesus spoke these words. Listen to what Jesus said to a man who had a son who was having all these seizures. Jesus said to him, "If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes." Let me tell you something this morning. All things, somebody say all things. All things are possible to them that believe. Do you believe it? What you're praying, amen? And so in order for our prayer to be effective, we got to make sure we got a sincere, true belief. We believe ourselves. And then the second thing, when I think about my prayer being effective, and because I got to be persistent and I want my prayer to be effective. And there's another piece. The authority of prayer is in Jesus' name. Oh, you got to know that. I'm not talking about when we go to certain events and we see people, they praying and they don't say anything about in Jesus' name. And I understand that sometimes some environments and folks, but listen, there is power in the name of Jesus. There is authority of prayer in Jesus' name. There is power in his name. But the reality is because his name carry weight in heaven, his name carry weight on the earth, and his name definitely carry weight in hell. That's real talk. We have the right, y'all, to use his name. There's authority of prayer in the name of Jesus. When I think about something legal, I thought about we have a power of attorney. Some of you know what power of attorneys are, right? Or a power of attorney is. It's this legal document. It's we have the power of attorney through the name of Jesus. And when I think about power of attorney, the reality is it's the legal or the ability to legally act on the behalf of another. When you give somebody power of attorney, when you actually give them that document, that person is really like over your personal business affairs. They have the right to sign letters and sign notes. They have the right to sign checks, to put your signature on legal documents on your behalf. When we pray in the name of Jesus and the authority that's connected to the name of Jesus, we have the power of attorney. We have legal right to declare some things in Jesus' name, amen. You got a right. And you can do that. You have power of attorney. Jesus himself, he expressed this principle when he said, "And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son." If you ask anything in my name, I'm going to do it. I know in that particular text in John chapter 14, he's dealing with these greater works. And he said, "Listen, I'm getting ready to go to heaven, but greater works you're going to do because I'm going with the Father." But we gonna, but he talked about a little bit of sending a comfort. And not only we was talking about the power of what they're getting ready to do, but it was more the extension of it. Because these disciples were getting ready to, man, just turn the world upside down. And so they said, whatever you ask in my name, there's some things that you're going to have to do that we all have to do. And we got to come boldly with this. And we got to pray in Jesus' name and use it. And he said, if you ask anything in my name, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. And so there's another one I think about. Not only do we need to have this sincere, true belief, and not only the authority of prayers in Jesus' name, this third piece, when I think about being effective, praying in harmony or in agreement with God's word, amen, or God's will, because God's will is his word. So praying in harmony or in agreement with God's will. Because the text says, I was thinking about 1 John 5 and 14. He says something like, "Now this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us." He hears us. That's good. To pray according to God's will is to pray in accord with what he wants. What he wants, not what we desire or insist that he do for us, is praying what he wants. See, that's the key, because when we praying in agreement with God's will, amen. And so the reality is a lot of times when I think about this, in many instances we know God's will because he has revealed it in his word. You want to know what God's will is for your life? I get in the word. It's in his word. Some folks say, "If it be the Lord's will." A lot of us grew up saying that. We said, everybody said, "If it be the Lord's will," and amen, if it be the Lord's will. But the reality is we can be sure that any prayer based on the promises in God's word will indeed be effective. God's will is his word. Pray the word, amen. Understanding God's will. And so when I think about praying in harmony or in agreement with God's will, that's important. So those are some things I wanted to give you as it relates to being effective. We gotta make sure we have a true belief. We believe what we're praying. It's time out for wavering back and forth. We gotta believe what we're praying, amen. We gotta believe it ourselves, and we gotta use the authority of Jesus' name when we pray, because there is some power in the name of Jesus. And not only that, we gotta be in harmony and agreement with God's will, amen. And so now as I get ready to just really push the rest of this message, I want to go back and look at this, what I call this, the parable of this persistent widow. Because I'm calling it today persistent. It's the key or the secret of prayer, being persistent. What can we learn from this widow here? And let's go to Luke chapter 18. We've already kind of initially went over there. Verses, let's go to 1-8. And the text read, "Then he spoke a parable to them that men always ought to pray and not lose heart, saying, there was in a certain city a judge who did not fear God nor regard man. Now there was a widow in that city, and she came to him saying, 'Get justice for me from my adversary.' And he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, 'Though I do not fear God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me.' And then the Lord said, 'Hear what the unjust judge said, and shall God not avenge his own elect who cry out day and night to him, though he bears long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth?" And so as I go back and I begin to look at some of these things here, and I want to see what can we learn from this persistent widow. Oh, she's special. There's a few things I believe that we can learn. And verse 1 says that he spoke a parable to them that men ought to pray and not lose heart. Don't you stop praying. Don't you stop praying. One of the things I want to tell you, even before I go any further, here's a thought. We have a duty to persevere in prayer. We have a duty to persevere. We got to be persistent. Yeah, he says men always ought to pray. We ought to always ought to pray. We got to persevere in prayer regardless of what's going on around us. We got to pray in all matters until Jesus returns. Yes, right. We got to bring it to the Lord. We got to talk to him about it. We got to get guidance from him, because that's how we get some direction. We got to persevere in prayer. I know there's a lot of things going on, and I know here even in the text, he was reminding us believers, we have to persevere in prayer. We got to be persistent. I think about how Jesus taught perseverance in prayer. When I looked over in Matthew 7:7-8, and he said something like this. He said, "Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds," right? "And to him who knocks, it will be opened." And now when I think about this, this is a continued action. We got to keep asking, we got to keep seeking, and we got to keep knocking. Even when we don't understand the thing, we got to keep asking. We got to keep asking, because to me, asking implies consciousness of a need, that belief that God hears our prayer. We have to understand that asking God and believe that he hears our prayer. And we got to keep seeking. Oh, we got to keep seeking, because to me that implies earnest petitioning along with obedience to God's will. We be specific and we petition God. We keep seeking. And then he talks about knocking, keep on knocking. God says, keep on knocking. I understand what it looked like and how things are going and what's going on around you, but keep on knocking, because it implies perseverance and coming to God even when he does not respond quickly. If you don't think God is responding to you quickly, keep a knocking. If you don't think things are happening quick enough for you in your life, keep a knocking. If things are just seem like they're not happening, there's no change, keep a knocking. We gotta ask, we gotta seek, and we gotta knock. Jesus taught us to be persevere. He taught perseverance in prayer. Oh, we can't allow what's going on around us to just slow us down. And when I see verse 2, and so now he begins to set this up. He's saying, there was in a certain city a judge who did not fear God. Listen to the obstacle. Listen to the conditions. What can we get from this? It's saying there was in a certain city a judge who did not fear God nor regard man. This man was definitely a wicked guy. Oh, this dude was wicked. He had no fear for God and reverenced God at all. He cared even less for what men had to say. And the idea here, when you think about this text, the idea is that he took bribes and he gave favors to persons who held positions and authority. It was all about what he can get for himself and how he can fat his pocket and so forth. But Jesus described him as an unjust man. When I get down here to verse 6, he describes him as unjust. Because the truth of the matter is, the judge in this particular verse, he's not identified as a symbol of God, but rather in contrast to God. Well, I'm going somewhere with this. He's not a symbol of God, but rather contrast to God. Because if such an unjust man, If such an unjust man would respond to some persistent pleas or some persistent prayers, would not God, who is not only just, but also God is loving and God is merciful, do you think he would hesitate? He wouldn't hesitate. And so when I think about this thing here, that there was a certain city, this judge, I want to tell you, as I think about this widow, as she's going through this process and she's going and she's pressing, do not allow obstacles to hinder you from praying. Don't allow your obstacles, whatever it might be. I don't care if it's a judge. Don't let it hinder you from praying. I don't care if it's a system, if it's a governmental system, whatever system's that in place, it's an obstacle. Do not allow obstacles to hinder you from praying. It didn't matter. She was a widow and he was a judge. You see the two different extremes. Most of the time, widows, they don't have a whole lot right. And you got this powerful judge, because the reality is obstacles can be moved. But you got to stay persistent in your prayer. You got to continue to pray and bombard heaven, amen, with your prayers. Because the reality is the wicked can be broken. Oh, yes, he can. Yes, he can. The wicked can be broken. And so when I see here in the text, verse 3 says that now there was a widow. Now let's see the difference from her. We heard about the judge, but the text said there was a widow in that city, and she came to him saying, get justice for me from my adversary. Oh my goodness, this widow. See, this widow was poor. Y'all know back in the day when you was a widow, but God told us we need to visit our widows and our orphans who are in trouble. We need to visit with them, right? The widow, she was poor, she had no money to bribe the judge. She didn't. She had nobody to help her to secure legal counsel for her, to plead her case for her. She didn't have any of that. She held no position of authority. She was a widow at that time. Most of the widows, considered really poor. She had no authority, no rights to advance to see the judge. But she was persecuted and being taken advantage of, abused by some adversary. Don't specifically talk about who the adversary is, but I can kind of think maybe it was around money, or maybe she's not able to pay her bills, and because if she's a widow, her husband passed away and so forth. I'm kind of adding that in there, but the reality is somebody was giving her a hard time. She had an adversary, because that's what the reality is. We have to always remember that you got a real live adversary in this earth, in this life. Oh, you got an enemy. Oh, every one of us, we have an adversary. Because what she did, she didn't let none of that stop her from going to see this judge. She came to the judge and she asked him, avenge me. Avenge me. In other words, give me some legal protection. Get rid of my adversary. She was inquiring about this. She was inquiring, but you know what? I want to tell you, as I'm looking at this, the reality is don't allow your status. I know she was a widow, but don't allow your status in life to stop you from facing your giants. It don't matter where you are. It don't matter how much education you got. It doesn't matter where you from or what part of the city you from. It doesn't matter what your last name is. Don't allow your status to stop you from facing your giants. If you are a prayer warrior, God is reminding us to stay persistent in our prayer. We stay persistent. This sister here, she pressed in and she went to talk to the judge. And so when I think about another thought I want to give you, persistent prayer can protect us from the evil one. Oh my God. I'm talking about these adversaries she had, these adversaries. Persistent praying can protect you from the evil one. I mean, that's real talk, y'all. Persistent prayer. Oh yeah, persistent. And when I see verses 4 and 5, As I think about her, it goes on and says, and he would not for a while, talking about the judge, but afterward he said within himself, though I do not fear God, nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continuing coming she weary me. Oh, listen to what he's saying. She weary me. This was there when she went to him. The text says he would not for a while, he wouldn't hear or respond. There was absolute silence from the judge. No words. The judge didn't move to help. He wouldn't. See, this particular judge here, he wasn't them kind of guys that was moved by compassion. You coming in with your sad story. See, that's how the world is. The world ain't interested in your sad story. That's why we have to be persistent in our prayer. That's why we have to depend on God and come to God in spite of what's going on around us. But the reality is this judge didn't move to help her at all. He had no interest in helping her. And there'll be some times in your life, there's some folk, they don't have no interest in helping you. They don't care nothing about your plight. They hear what you got going on. And you know what I'm saying? Some folks won't even budge. But the reality is, if he couldn't benefit out of this, he didn't feel like he wanted to help her. But I want to tell you something. Just because silence and folks don't respond, a thought I want to give you, do not allow silence to dictate your next move. Don't you allow, just because somebody don't respond or you don't get the answer that you were looking for, don't allow that to dictate your next move. You got to keep praying, baby. You got to stay persistent. You got to pray things through, because the reality is, silence or no response does not necessarily mean nothing is happening. Oh my goodness. Silence or no response doesn't mean nothing is really happening, or you're not being heard. Oh, don't get it twisted. Because sometimes people are just processing it. And sometimes when folks' heart has been hardened, like this particular judge, he's used to a certain way of life and he just set in his ways. But it's something about praying. It's something about persisting in praying and calling things out and praying in Jesus' name and believing what you're praying is going to happen. Oh, it's something about it. It's something about it, because at the end of the day, delay does not necessarily mean denial. Just because the judge didn't respond, just because he didn't say nothing, and just because you didn't get the answer right then, that doesn't necessarily mean denial, amen. But she kept on coming. So you got to keep on coming. You got to keep on praying. We got to keep on praying. Even when things are not moving quick enough, even when you don't know how things going to turn out, you got to keep coming. You got to keep praying. You got to keep pleading. She would not let the judge rest. She kept coming back. Oh, she kept coming back. And note, the judge is stressed. Now, the judge is starting to get stressed. Why I say that? Because he says, I do not fear God or regard man's opinions. But yet, he kind of given in to this widow. Why do you think that he's starting to give in to this widow? Because of her persistent praying, because of her commitment to continue, because the reality is, what the judge would not do out of compassion for the widow or even for the reference of God, he would do out of sheer frustration with her continued pleading. Listen, the reality is, here's the thought I want to tell you when I think about how he started getting stressful. Persistent prayer will frustrate your enemy to act. You just keep praying. You just keep praying, because this judge is starting to get frustrated. This lady keep coming back here. I'm tired of seeing this little lady. She constantly asking me to help her. She don't take no for answer. And that's how you gotta be when your life is on the line, when somebody is dependent on you. Listen, you gotta continue. You gotta stay to your ground. You gotta continue to pray, because persistent prayer will frustrate your enemy. When you pray, your enemy get frustrated. Oh my goodness, you praying to God, and then don't have the nerve to pray in the spirit. Hallelujah. Don't have the nerve to pray with your heavenly language. And the enemy gets confused. But I can tell you this, persistent prayer, this sister kept on praying. She kept on coming. And things begin to shift for her. He begins frustration. He got frustrated out of her praying and showing up and pleading. Listen, we don't serve a God like that. We don't serve a God. This judge was like that. But in this life, there are going to be some times where folks are not going to respond to you. There are going to be some times on these jobs, things are not happening the way you want it to happen. But I'm here to tell you, there's something about being persistent when you pray and believing when you pray that you receive it now in Jesus' name. There's something that takes place in the spiritual realm. You got to stay right there. You got to stay right there. So when I look at verse 6 and 7, it says, then the Lord said, now listen, he says, hear what the unjust judge said. And shall God not avenge his only elect who cry out day and night to him, though he bears long with them? I thought it was interesting, because now I see this unjust judge really trying to teach us a lesson. He had the audacity. It's interesting how people of the world, you know, they're going to try to, some of them try to quote the scriptures to you. Some of them try to, man, and you know, didn't they say they serve God? Didn't they say they Christians? Didn't they say they God is able? And didn't they say they was blessed of the Lord and highly favored? We say all that stuff. Listen what the judge says. Hear what the unjust judge said. Because he says, hear this lesson. Listen to the point of the story. In other words, give attention and thought to what this unjust judge is trying to teach us. Pay attention to what he's saying. What is he saying, Pastor? That's a great question. Because when I think about being persistent, and he says that, and shall God not avenge his own elect who cry out day and night to him, though he bears long with them? It's a very simple thought. God avenges his elect who persevere in prayer. These folks are praying. See, you got to pray at night. You got to pray during the day. You got to continue to press in. The elect of God's own elect, I'm talking about followers of Jesus Christ, persevering in faith and holiness, will never cease crying out to God for Christ's return to destroy, I believe, Satan's power and this present evil world system. We got to stay praying. We got to continue to pray. And the reality is, when I think about this here, this indicates that they are in trouble. When we are praying night and day, when we are crying out to God, it indicates that there's some type of trouble, that we need to be avenged and delivered from being ridiculed. We need to be avenged and delivered from being ignored and being slandered and being cursed, amen. So many of us have been being criticized here in the earth. A lot of us are being abused and passed over for things and being persecuted. It's time for us to be avenged, amen. It really is. So we got to continue to pray. We got to stay persistent. Don't you stop praying. You continue to pray. I understand what it looks like and things are not moving like you wanted to move. And sometimes you don't feel like, how are you going to make it? It's time to pray. You got to be persistent in your prayer. The reason God avenges his elect is because they persevere in prayer. The text said they pray day and night. Do we really pray that much? Does it take that much in times like these? Absolutely. You better be praying. You better be praying. We get on the phone and we calling folks and we trying to Google stuff online. We better start praying. God has every answer that you need. Everything you need. The word of God is the answer. He has everything that we need. They had a great need. They crying day and night. And they recognize that God alone can meet a need. When you crying out day and night, you know that God can meet that need. And so when I think about, as I'm winding this thing up, and I'm looking at this widow woman, and how persistent she was in her prayer life. She had a need, and she recognized, only God can help me. She recognized, I'm gonna go to this unjust judge. And here it is, this unjust judge started talking about our God, that how he's patient with us, and how he responds to those who cry out day and night. Let me tell you something, we serve a living and a good God, amen. And so when I look at verse 8, and how it sums it up, I tell you, and it says this, I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Oh, we're talking about our God. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, Jesus is coming back. Oh, let me let you know, he's coming back. When the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth? Did you just hear that question? Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth? It's interesting that the condition of the world and the question he's asking now, and even today with all the stuff going on in our nation. Matter of fact, I had a conversation with my son, man. He's a little concerned about the future. He's a little concerned about how things are going to look and things are going to get better. But I reminded him, no matter how it turns out, to be in Christ, we're in a win-win situation, amen. And so we don't have to worry. We just need to stay focused, amen, and live peacefully. We got to stay focused and live peacefully. But the reality is, in God's time, he will act quickly. In God's time, he'll move suddenly. In God's time, and without hesitation, I'm serious, he'll do that. His wrath will come upon the earth. Oh, I know we don't like to hear stuff like that. But the reality is, he's going to deal with this stuff here on the earth. He's going to put an end to the distress and the suffering received at the hand of hostile and this evil world. Oh, he's going to handle his business. God's going to do that. But I thought it was interesting that says, when the Son of Man come, will he really find faith in the earth? Man, that's a big question. What are you saying? Because I want to tell you, it's my last thought here, persistent prayer is counted as faith. You got to stay persistent. Think about what's going on. Because here's the great tragedy. You know what the great tragedy is? The great tragedy is that in these last days, few people are going to persevere in prayer and faith. Folks are just, listen, people are just overwhelmed. There's some folks who are walking away from God. There's some folks that prayer ain't working. You've heard it. You don't see things moving. You're still trying to figure out why all this stuff happening. We having an explosion in our nation right now. And listen, if folks are getting anxious and really, and a lot of them are getting discouraged. But that's the tragedy, because in the last days, few folks, matter of fact, Christians, there's going to be few of us who are going to persevere in faith and in prayer. The reality is evil, y'all, is going to become so dominant. And you're seeing it taking place right now. Evil is so dominant in our particular earth that many folks in the church, many folks going to fall away from the genuine faith. Some folks going to walk away from it. Matter of fact, you've seen some people who used to walk with God, but now they're not walking with God. And you ask them why, they don't want to explain, or they start giving you all these excuses. That's because they were not persistent in things and happening on their time schedule. Listen, God don't operate on our time. God is outside of time. Hey, listen, God knows the end at the beginning. He's the creator of heaven and earth. And so the reality is, if you don't move when he wants, when you think he ought to move, you don't need to get discouraged. Folks here, y'all, persistent prayer is counted as faith. You got to stay persistent, because as we approach history's end, as this is where my son was making his comment, you know, Dad, I think we're in our last days. Matter of fact, we've been in our last days ever since Jesus went to heaven. You know, you really study that out. Listen, every generation has literally said that, I'm sure. But we're starting to see more signs. And so as we approach the end, and the question for each of us should be, am I persevering in faith? Are you persevering in faith? That's a good question. Another question, am I continuing steadfast in prayer and calling on God that justice may be done and his righteousness cause may triumph completely and forever? Or am I so occupied? Are you so occupied? Are we so occupied with this life? We get so caught up with this life. How many know this life, this place is not our home? We just passing through. We're just foreigners, right? We're just strangers in a foreign land. We're just passing through. Are we so occupied with this life that I'm not even looking forward to Christ's return? Are we so engaged and we're so busy and we're not praying anymore? We're not hearing from God. We're not getting any revelation. We're not getting any clarity. We have to be persistent in our prayer. We got to be persistent, because he asked the question, when the Son of Man comes, will we really find faith in the earth? Man, Jesus saying this is almost as if faith gonna be a rarity. I mean, it's almost like, man, y'all better hold on to your faith, because that's the only thing that's gonna work at the end of the world. That's the only thing God's gonna be looking for, our faith. Because the just shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. And so, are there gonna be any faith? And so, precious people, we got to stay persistent in praying, because it's counted as faith. And so what I get from this lady, man, I'm telling you, this widow, she worked this thing out and she stayed consistent. God wants you and us to stay consistent. We got to stay persistent in our prayer life. Persevere in praying. Don't stop praying. It's time to pray. Look all around you. It's time to pray. Amen. And so listen, if you're looking at this, if you've listened to this sermon this morning, and you're saying, Pastor, I ain't been praying a whole lot, and I need to pray. Matter of fact, I want to be saved. If you're there today and you're listening, you online with us this morning, and you've never had an opportunity to receive Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want to lead you probably in the most powerful, most important prayer. That's the prayer of salvation for you. That right where you are, Jesus is going to come to live on the inside of you. He's going to dwell on the inside of you. You're going to be a part of the body. And so just repeat after me. Say, Dear God, I'm a sinner, and I don't want to be a sinner anymore. I repent of my sins. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and he died on the cross for me so I can be right with you. And you raised him from the dead, God. Jesus, come into my heart and be my Lord and Savior. And I thank you today, God, for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's bless God right there. Listen, if you said that prayer, your life was changed. Now it's time to continue praying. It's time for you to persevere and pray, man. Get connected to a Word Teaching Church. Listen, we'd love for you to connect with us here at Empowerment Word Church. But listen, I pray today that this message has blessed your heart, because we got to stay persistent, because that's the secret of prayer. Amen. Listen, happy Father's Day again to all my fathers. I pray you have a wonderful day. And listen, treat them good, y'all. Treat your dads and fathers good. Amen. Y'all be blessed, and I'll see you next week. Amen. Amen.
Thank you for watching today. We hope this message has been a blessing to you. We would love to connect with you. Follow us on social media, on Facebook and Instagram at Empowerment Word Church. You can also view this and other messages from Empowerment Word Church on Facebook and YouTube. If you are blessed by this message and would like to support the ministry, simply go to empowermentwordchurch.com and select the Give tab at the top of the page. Remember to live, fulfill, and be, and we'll see you next time.